Oh, he seems like just an ordinary man, with dirty feet and rough but gentle hands. But the words he says are hard to understand, and yet he seems like just an ordinary man.
Good morning, and welcome to our service of worship. I'm delighted that you are able to come and to share with us this morning, no matter where you are. The psalmist says, I was glad when they said, let us go to the house of the Lord. And really what he was saying was that he was delighted to come into God's presence. And no matter where you are today, I do trust that you would know the blessing of his hand upon you.
And does what is right at all times. We bless you that you are the one who is kind and faithful. And from you day by day we receive blessings in great number. Help us to remember to bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me bless his holy name, and to forget not all his benefits. We thank you for the gift of life, for the breath that we breathe, for the joy of life and living. We give you our thanks. For as the Bible reminds us, it is in you we live and move and have our being. We pray for those just now who are finding life a struggle, those who are ill, those who are finding being confined to their homes stressful, for those who are lonely and afraid. We pray, Lord, that they might be assured of your loving presence at this time. We give you thanks that you are the Lord of creation, that the heavens declare your glory. We thank you for the brightness of the sun and the beauty of the spring flowers. All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all. We thank you, Lord, for the wonder of your amazing love to us, shown in the person of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you that there was no other good enough to pay the price of sin, that he only could unlock the gate of heaven and let us in. So as we prepare our hearts for worship, we ask that by the Holy Spirit we might in these moments seek you with all of our hearts, to find rest in you for our troubled lives, to find peace in the midst of all that is happening around us, to find joy in our sorrows, to discover your love and grace to us in Jesus, your Son, to rest secure in the knowledge that you're working all things together for good to those who love you, and that through the Lord Jesus, nothing can ever separate us from your great love. Lord, while we cannot meet together in this meeting house, we thank you that no matter where we are, your presence goes with us. So no matter where we are today, give us the awareness of your loving presence and help us to hear you speak into our lives. Enable us to hear and respond to your word that is given to bless us, to rebuke us, to correct us, but to make us more like Jesus. Once more, Lord, we pray for those who have the responsibility to govern our land, asking that you will give them wisdom and guide them in all that they seek to do in these days. Lord, we pray with thankfulness for all those who are working in these days to make life as easy as possible for us and others, for doctors and nurses, for all involved in the National Health Service. We pray especially for those in our congregation who work in hospitals. We pray and thank you for those who serve in many different ways. We thank you for shop workers, for lorry drivers, for farmers, for bin men, for postmen, for delivery drivers, for anyone and everyone who are working in these days. We thank you for the privilege of prayer, and we thank you that we pray together the words that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Our reading is taken from St. Luke chapter 24 and verses 13 to 35 on the road to Emmaus. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened in these days?"
Forlorn footsteps follow the pathway of denial, the pathway to Emmaus, down 7 endless miles. Forsaken, hopeless followers, faithlessly assumed. There's no one left to follow, hope was buried in the tomb. As they discuss and argue, and want to disagree, before we're only two were, now suddenly they're three.
"What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he would be the one that was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning but didn't find his body. They came and told us they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus."
"What things were you discussing? Could you explain to me?" he asked as he stepped out beyond the edge of mystery. But their pain and disappointment was more than they could tell, for they had hoped he was the one to rescue Israel. How foolish of heart, how slow to believe. Come be reconciled on these 7 endless miles. How foolish of heart, how slow to believe. Come be reconciled. seven endless miles.
How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going further. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them.
Faith will see beyond the mysteries disguised. Miracle of broken bread can open up your eyes. Faith will see beyond the mysteries disguised. The miracle of broken bread can open up your eyes.
When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized with them when he broke the bread.
On these seven endless miles, how foolish of heart, how slow to believe. Come be reconciled on these seven endless miles.
Although what we're going through at the moment could be described as anything but normal, we are trying to follow the normal church pattern. So next week would be our Communion Sunday. And I want to encourage you that we're going to share communion together. I'm not going to ask the elders to drive around and distribute the elements to you. So as you come to this time next week, if you could have some bread and a glass with you, and we will take communion together.
Hello again, girls and boys. Jesus is alive. Not just was alive. He is alive. Easter isn't over.
We continue to celebrate Christ's resurrection, and today, Nick will tell us about Jesus' unexpected encounter with some disciples on the road to Emmaus. How would you have felt if you had known about the death of Jesus, and then heard people talking about him being alive? Sometimes things in our lives don't make sense to us. Even if we know God is at work, we have a difficult time understanding what he might be doing. But God's big plans will always come through. Listen to this wee poem from Go Chatter to help us all understand.
Two people, moving and marching, thinking, head scratching, about something big that's just been happening. But on the road to Emmaus from Jerusalem way, two became three as another says, "Hey, hey," says he, "you've been thinking and head scratching. Has something big just been happening?" "You've not heard about what's been happening? All of Jerusalem have been head scratching." "What have I missed?" asks the man. "I'd love to know. Please tell if you can." "It's about a man called Jesus, and we thought he was coming to rescue God's people and send the Romans off running. He did, and he said loads of cool stuff from a place up north called Nazareth. He told great stories and healed the sick. He knew people by name and what made them tick. Oh, remember that wedding? He turned water to wine, brought his friend back to life, and his friend felt just fine. He was sharing and caring, just ask his friend Pete. He walked on the water with only his feet. He said shush to the storm and the storm was hushed. He did a miracle with bread and thousands were stuffed. Besides all this, his sermon up a hill had so many stories, super cool and brill. I can't believe it. What a big loss. A man so great who hung on a cross, and on that cross, that's where he died. I feel so tied up in knots inside. And 3 days have passed, though it feels more like 70, because now we've heard that his tomb is empty. That's right, you heard me. His body is gone. But who'd take his body? He never did wrong. You seem confused and out of the picture. So let me show you what it says in the scripture. It was always the plan, right from the start, because Jesus loves you with all of his heart. He died on the cross, but rose from the tomb. He came back to life so you can live too. And as they were moving, and still head scratching, two of them stopped, but the third kept on marching. Don't go, please, the two say. The sun's gone to bed, so why don't you stay? Good point, says the third. Day has turned to night. I'll stop over with you two and then grab a bite. And as they sit down to eat, they close their eyes. He thanks God for the grub, then what a surprise! The two people stare and then rub their eyes. It's Jesus, not gone, but fully alive! And before they say seconds, there's more bread going round. Jesus just vanishes. He cannot be found. The two are left thinking and really head scratching. They'd just been with Jesus. Something big was happening. We must say we've seen Jesus, so tie up your shoes. Quick, to Jerusalem. There's no time to lose. All along it was Jesus, the very same one. They were searching the scriptures with God's precious son. It's the biggest story that's ever been told. About Jesus who's risen, it never gets old. The two met with Jesus in the most surprising way. They shared the story, and we still share it today.
Jesus didn't reveal who he was to the disciples immediately. And sometimes we don't recognize him either, until later on.
In the Bible we learn that Jesus asks these men why they seem sad. Ironically, they proceed to tell Jesus about himself by going back through the Bible, describing what has happened and how he died.
He tells the men how his own coming had been told throughout scripture and prophets.
But Jesus is patient, and takes time to go over who he is again. Yet somehow the disciples still don't quite comprehend who they are talking to.
But when they were eating together, Jesus prayed, and finally they recognized him. Once they understood, they certainly would never be the same again. Everything suddenly made sense.
Have you ever seen a movie or read a book that seemed completely mysterious? And then there was a plot twist or a conclusion that helped things all come together in a grand aha moment.
That must have been what they experienced here. All of the sorrow and confusion was brought into the light.
What does this mean for us?
Well, sometimes things happen to us that can't be understood or explained until later. Maybe we go through a hard time, and later on that helps someone else experiencing the same thing.
Maybe we are running late, but it helps avoid an accident.
Maybe we lose something we wanted, but gain something even greater.
Sometimes we don't understand why things happen, and we might not truly understand until we get to heaven.
But we know God is working.
In Romans 8, verse 28, he promises us that he is always working for the good of those who love him.
We don't always recognize what he is doing.
Sometimes he uses people around us, or events, to help work out his ways.
He can even use time like this when we are all apart from each other, staying safe at home.
We need to pray each day, and of course get to know him through the Bible.
We can keep an eye out for how he might be working, and ask him to use us for his purposes too.
Bye for now, everyone.
Bye.
Our response to the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead is really the same as our response to anything in life. We see, we hear, we question, we consider, and we either believe or we do not. On Sunday the 20th of July in 1969, as hundreds of millions on Earth watched on their televisions, the first man set foot on the moon. I was 3 years old I sat on my grandfather's knee in front of our black and white television and watched those images flicker across the screen. When Neil Armstrong stepped down onto the lunar surface, he remarked, "That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind." But did you believe it? Did you believe what you saw on television? In the midst of all the conspiracies that we hear today, do you still believe that Neil Armstrong walked on the moon? No wonder do you remember where you were on the morning of the 11th of September in 2001, as those planes crashed into the World Trade Center in New York. Maybe you thought, this can't be true, but it was true. Maybe you saw the smoke pour from those towers and you thought, this can't be happening, but it was. Or the speed with which we went from normal life into the current lockdown. Some events are very real, even though we may question them. Whereas there are other events that may not be so real, and we should question them. I wonder if you remember seeing that illusionist David Copperfield when he made an aeroplane disappear. I didn't believe it, but I couldn't explain it. But Copperfield is an illusionist. He creates illusions. It's not real. While we may not completely understand how someone like David Copperfield performs those illusions, it's fascinating, but it's not believable. It's entertaining, but it's not reality. And so what about the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead? Was this merely an illusion? An illusion to make people believe in a person who was not real or wasn't who he claimed to be? Do we believe him or do we not? Do you believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead or do you not? So let's look at some of the responses today to the resurrection of Jesus. You see, there are those who see Jesus but do not recognize him. The story is told of a burglar who broke into a house and he was looking around and he heard a soft voice from behind him saying, "Jesus is watching you." He thought it was his imagination, so he carried on his search. Then again he heard that voice, "Jesus is watching you." He turned his torch around and saw a parrot in a cage and asked the parrot if it was the one who had been talking. "Yes," said the parrot. He asked the parrot its name. The parrot replied, "Moses." The burglar said, "What kind of person would name a parrot Moses?" The parrot replied, "The same kind of person that would name their Rottweiler Jesus." I believe in Jesus. I have no question in my mind that Jesus is who he said he was. He is God's son, come from heaven onto earth to perform miracles, to raise the dead, to feed the multitudes, to cast out demons. That he died on a cross, bearing our sin in his body, so that we might believe, trust in him, and be in heaven with him for all eternity. But yet there are many people who only consider Jesus briefly. Somehow they are kept from believing in him and trusting in him as their saviour. Verses 13 to 16 of our text say, "Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. And as they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. But they were kept from recognizing him." These two disciples saw Jesus, but they were kept from recognizing him as they walked along. They did believe, but they didn't recognize Jesus at this time. In this incident, Jesus kept them from seeing who he was. But in the world today, it's a different story. It's not Jesus who keeps people from recognizing who he is and what he can do for them. Their eyes are blinkered by the things of this world. Obviously, Jesus wants people to believe in him, to trust in him for their salvation. H.G. Wells said, "I am an historian. I'm not a believer, but I must confess that as a historian that this penniless preacher from Nazareth is irrevocably the very centre of history. Jesus Christ is easily the most dominant figure in all of history." At least Wells considered Jesus. John Lennon said, "Christianity will go. It will vanish and shrink. You needn't argue with that because I am right and I will be proved right. We, the Beatles, are more popular than Jesus now. I don't know which will go first, rock and roll or Christianity." Well, as we know, John Lennon has been gone since 1980 when he was shot at the age of 40. But Christianity, it still goes on. Many people today talk about Jesus and Christianity in very general ways. They don't seem to recognize that Jesus is the Son of God. I think they want to believe, but this world keeps them from recognizing Jesus as the Son of God. Why would a person not want to believe in heaven? For we know that our life on this earth will come to an end. So would you not want to believe in a life thereafter? Does it not just seem sensible to believe in Jesus and heaven? And yet there are many people who are kept from believing. So what is it that keeps them from believing? Well, it's not God. It's the world. It's the world and the evil one that blocks people from believing in Jesus and his promise of eternal life. Over in 1 John 2 from 15 to 17 it says, "Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For everything in the world, the cravings of sinful man, the lust of his eyes, and the boasting of what he has and does, comes not from the Father, but from the world. The world and its desires pass away, but the man who does the will of God lives forever." There's a man that once came up to the preacher D.L. Moody and said to him, "Now that I am converted, must I give up on the world?" "No," replied the evangelist, you need not give up on the world. If you give a ringing testimony to the Son of God, the world will give up on you very quickly. This world is not our friend. In Peter 5, verse 8, it says, "Be self-controlled and alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour." There is our warning. There's a story of three apprentice devils who were coming to earth to finish their assistantship. And they're talking to Satan, the chief of all the devils. They talk to him about their plans and how to ruin men. The first said, "I will tell men that there is no God." Satan said, "That will not delude many, for they know that there is a God." The second said, "I will tell them that there's no hell." Satan replied to him, "You will deceive no one that way, for everyone knows that because of sin there is hell." The third assistant devil said, "I will tell them there is no hurry." "Go," said Satan, "and you will ruin men by the thousand." The most dangerous illusion of all is that there is plenty of time. Some people may consider that Jesus, but they don't come to faith because Satan and the world are suppressing any faith that might develop in them. There are those who see Jesus but do not recognize him. And then there are those who know the scripture but do not believe in it. Verses 25 to 27, he said to them, "How foolish you are and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Christ have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scripture concerning himself." Essentially, Jesus is saying to these two men, "How foolish you are not to believe the scripture." scriptures are the living and abiding word of God as we believe them to be, then surely only a fool would not believe what is written. Charles Spurgeon said, "I would recommend that you either believe God up to the hilt or else not to believe at all. Believe this book of God, every letter of it, or else reject it, because there is no logical standing place between the two." Do you believe in the message of the scriptures? Do you believe what it says about Jesus, about his life on earth, about his ministry, about his death on the cross, and his resurrection from the dead? Be assured, your very life hangs in the balance of whether you believe or not, because God means just what he says. If you read on from verses 30 to 35, we're told, when he was at the table with them, he took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him. They disappeared from their sight. And they asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" And they got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true. The Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. These men finally got it. They finally believed that message about Jesus. And what was it they did? They said, "It is true. The Lord has risen from the dead." And they believed and they wanted to spread that message of the risen Christ. One Sunday morning, a minister was preaching and he noticed a young solicitor in the congregation. After the service was over, he made his way to the young man and asked him, "Are you a Christian?" "Well, sir," he said, "I consider myself a Christian." The minister asked, "Are you bringing other men to Christ?" The young man said, "No, that's not my job, that's yours. I'm not called to do that. I'm called to practice law. You are called to preach the gospel." The minister responded, "You are called to be a Christian. And you are called to bring men to Christ." The young man said, "Well, I don't believe that." Whereupon the minister took his Bible, he turned to Acts 8 verse 4 where it says, "They therefore that were scattered abroad went about preaching the word." Those who were scattered were the early Christians. And as they scattered, they also preached Christ. Someone once said that if a man has religion, he is bound to do one of two things with it. Give it up or give it away. If it isn't true, he must give it up. But if it is true, he must give it away. And so this morning, I have three questions for you. Do you recognize Jesus? Do you believe in God's word? And if so, does your life reflect that? May God's blessing be upon you. Amen.
Oh,
the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, may they rest and abide on each one of us, both now and forevermore. Amen.
The gentle healer, he left our town today. I just looked around and found he'd gone away. Some folks from town have followed him, they say, that the gentle healer is the truth, the love.